Thank you, Justin and team. Good morning, church. Jesus loves me, this I know. Oh, this is a song that I remember I used to sing in Sunday school over and over again. Like Justin said, it's a very, very familiar song to us. When my daughter first learned piano, this is one of the first songs that she started learning with, that she learned to play. We used to sing it during communion, if you remember, but I haven't really heard it in the last 3 years. Well, it was originally written for a child who was ill. The song contains simple words that speak of two things: the enduring love of God and a divine care for those who are in hardship. Perhaps this is why it became China's favorite hymn. You see, in the 18th century, the missionaries to China brought this hymn to the country as part of their evangelistic effort. Now, during the late 1800s and early 1900s, many Chinese people were exposed to Christianity for the first time. And Jesus Loves Me became one of the hymns that was used to teach the gospel message. The simple melody and message resonated with many Chinese people, especially children, and it quickly became a top hit in Sunday schools and church services. So much so that in the Baptist hymnal, the tune to this song was named China. The popularity of the hymn continued to grow throughout the 20th century, despite periods of persecution and suppression of Christianity. In fact, during the Cultural Revolution in the 60s and 70s, when religious expressions were severely restricted, Jesus Loves Me was one of the few Christian songs that remained widely known and cherished among the Chinese Christians. Why? Because this hymn tells us that the Christian faith is a simple yet profound truth of God's love. Even if life throws you lemons, even when things are difficult, we possess a love and endurance that will surpass all earthly troubles. And these must be the same comforting words that Paul wanted to encourage the Thessalonian church with. And these words are found in the solitary verse that I've been tasked to preach today. Simple words, but big theology. And it reads from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the patience of Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Come, let us pray before we begin. Dear Heavenly Father, as we are gathered here today to hear your word, we thank you for your infinite love and unending patience. Your love for us is immeasurable, and we are grateful for the ways you've shown us your love and care throughout our lives. We come before you today to ask for a deeper understanding of your love. As we listen to your word today, we pray that you speak to us in a way that is personal and meaningful. May the truth penetrate our hearts and transform our lives, that we may be more like Christ in all that we say and do. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen. Now, just to recap where we have left off from our last sermon before Holy Week that will form the context for our verse today, Pastor Bernard spoke about chapter 3 up to this point in the context is a call for the Thessalonian church to advance the gospel, if you remember that. And by now, we know that the circumstance surrounding the church is one of hostility and rife with false teachings when spreading the gospel, difficult in every sense of the word. And with the eschatological undertone here in chapter 3, Paul is beginning to conclude this letter, and he shares that he has confidence in the things that they will do and will be doing for the sake of the gospel. And therefore, he says these fine words. I kind of like the New Living Translation because it expresses what we are about to do today. May the Lord lead your hearts into a full understanding, an expression of the love of God and the patient endurance that comes from Christ. Now, let's unpack these words in order to have a full understanding and expression. Here I have three different divisions to guide us. Now, the first division, the love of God. Now, knowing that you are loved can be a great motivation. Even if you are hated by the world, knowing that you are loved by someone is comforting. Some time ago, a friend of mine raised this question: how do we know that God loves us? How do we know that God loves us? It's a fair question if you haven't thought about it before. It's like, hey, we can't see God. How to love? Especially when we'll most likely base our definition of love on our experience of fatherly or human love. If you have a good father, maybe you can see a glimpse of what love can be like. But if you have an absent or abusive father, then it is difficult for some to form an idea of what love looks like. In the biblical context, there are many different kinds of and degrees of love being used. And there are four Greek words that will form four main types of biblical love in the New Testament. You probably heard of them before, but let me just reiterate. The first one is this, storge love. Now, this type of love is often known as familial love. It is a type of love that is shared between family members. It is characterized by affection, care, and a sense of responsibility towards your family. Now, the second one is phileo or filial love. Now, this type of love is often referred to as brotherly love. So, my ex-cell group was called Philadelphia. The root word comes from phileo or philia, which means that we love one another. It's the kind of love that is shared between close friends or even can be used for family members. It is characterized by mutuality and sharing between persons. Now, the third type of love is eros love. Now, this type of love is often known as romantic love. And this is the type of love that is typically shared between two individuals in a relationship. It is characterized by intense longing or desiring, a need for physical connection, including but not limited to sexual desire. This is where the English word erotic comes from. Now, the fourth type of love, agape love. This type of love is often referred to as the unconditional love. And this is the highest form of love in the Bible. It is a type of love that God has for humanity. It is a selfless love that puts the needs of others before oneself. It is characterized by compassion, forgiveness, and a desire to help others without expecting anything in return. When we think about loving God, we often have this romanticized idea, a desire for physical connection, eros type of love, as it were. But that's where we run into a disconnect, when God doesn't seem to fulfill our idea of romantic love. But here, I want you to understand is that the love that God offers is unique from our idea of love. In fact, the meaning of agape is not likely found in historical or linguistic or philosophical reconstruction. Here, if we compare agape love and eros love, we will find a stark difference. Agape love is a giving kind of love. It reaches us. It is selfless. It is an inherent kind of love that loves its object even before there is any value to it. For instance, when God told Jesus, you know, this is my son whom I love. With him I'm well pleased. Remember that this is spoken even before his ministry began and not after the resurrection. It is a powerful reminder for all of us that God's agape love always comes before and is never contingent on what we can accomplish or achieve. Now, besides the different definitions of love, there are different ways in which love can be shown. We all show love differently. Now, that's why Gary Chapman's 5 love languages grew in popularity, because we as humans can't help falling in love, but at the same time struggle to understand this crazy little thing called love, and therefore sometimes give love a bad name by not knowing how to show and receive love. Those who are smiling, you are from that era. For me, my primary love language is acts of service. That is to say, when I do something for you, like I give you a lift home, I carry your heavy bags, when I cook or do house chores, it is my way of showing love. But sometimes, despite doing all that, my wife would ask me, I don't feel loved. Then I will respond, but I love you, what? Then my wife will say, if you never say, how I know? Now, this is happening because my wife's primary love language is words. And if you know my wife, she is a writer, an editor, and a journalist. Her primary mode of expression are words.
Now, humans in our limited capacity perceive love differently from individual to individual. No wonder it's hard for some of us to feel God's love. But this morning, I want to share with you that God's agape love encompasses all modes of love expressions. How? How do I know that God loves me? How can I be directed to God's love? Firstly, God professes His love for you through His Word. The Word of God is the primary source of knowledge about God's love and grace, and Jesus Christ is the acting agent of this knowledge, and the Holy Spirit helps us to understand in all of His fullness when we read the primary source. Now, you see, every now and then at home, I will pick up pieces of paper or find that in my bag. Notes from my daughters that often reads, "I love you, Papa. Thank you, Papa, for blah, blah, blah." You go like, "Aw," right? But look through the Bible and you realize that the B-I-B-L-E is not just basic instructions before leaving earth. It is a letter that is littered with awful lot of small notes to tell us how much God loves us and the ways to direct us to the love of God, to be close to Him. I would see it this way, that the Bible is God's love letter to humanity. It is the greatest love letter the world has ever known. In Jeremiah 31:3, God says that He loves us with an everlasting love. He has drawn us with loving devotion. In 1 John 3:1, we are told how great is the love that the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. In Isaiah 54, verse 10, poetically it says, "Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you." God has offered the greatest love letter in the world, unconditionally out of His agape love for you. But unless you stretch your hands out to hold it, to unfold it, you will never internalize the fullness of God's love for you. And I'm telling you today, my friends, that this love letter, this letter of love, is enveloped in the Word of God. Open it, enjoy it, unravel the mystery, recapture the wonder. Now, if your love language is not really words, it is through gifts, I tell you, my friend, today you have received the greatest gift of them all, a demonstration of His love through the giving of His Son, another expression of God's love for us. Romans and 1 John tells us clearly that God demonstrated His love for us while we are yet sinners. Christ died for us. And this is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. Now that is love. Now this is what it means when we sing, "Christ is my reward." The giving of Himself is the best gift that we can receive, and nothing can compare and be better than this. This is also the greatest act of service that we can ever receive. The supreme act of servanthood came when He died on the cross and gave His life as a ransom for us all. Now, this expression of love goes beyond the atonement of our sins, but it's a gift and an act that gives us new life, new hope, and new purpose. I remember when my wallet was all worn out and torn, and guys don't usually buy wallets. This is universal truth. You don't replace wallets. Usually the wife will replace it for you. And so my wife did. Many years ago, she gifted me a new wallet. I felt love from the expression of love of gift. But I also get to enjoy the newness of the wallet, the smell of the leather. And it's always a good feeling to have something new. So when God gave His Son for our sake to give us a newness of life, it is the ultimate human experience, the ultimate experience of humanity, and one of the best ways to know that you are loved. Now, besides the Word and the gift of Jesus, we can experience the revelation of His love through the Spirit in our everyday experiences. Now, I wanted to include this because perhaps this is the most challenging love language that we would struggle with, and that is of physical touch, from a divine being somehow. But have you ever heard someone say, "God touched my heart"? Have you ever felt a tingling in your heart? That stirring, that evoking of your spirit, man? To me, that is as physical as it can get through the Spirit. Because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with love. I remember there was once where we had a guest who came, and his name was Peter, and he was talking about the Father's love. And at that time, as a young man, I was struggling with the concept of an heavenly Father's love, because I cannot reconcile the fact that God is a transcendent God, but He is also an immanent Father. But here, Peter, in all of his wisdom, came and he said to me, "Come." And he gave me a hug. Peter has passed on for a decade now. But I'll always remember that hug. Because for the first time in my life, I felt God's physical presence, His touch in flesh through Peter. It was a revelation of His love in flesh for me. Maybe it's not physical touch as we know it, but we can experience God in a very real and tangible way. Perhaps God has revealed His love for all of you in different ways. But in our lives, experience, we have different touch points with God. And I think there are many stories out there about God's provision, answered prayers, the prompting of the Holy Spirit to do this and that in our daily ethics. And we are told that this Spirit will be with us forever. It's like quality time 24/7. If I were to just preach based on God's revelation of His love through the experiences that I have had, we'll be here for days. And just a side note, remember to write these things down. Just like the book of convictions, I'm also in the midst of compiling a book of testimonies of God's goodness and faithfulness in my life. I think that on days where I feel unloved or I feel, rejected by this world, I can look back and be amazed by God's love through many experiences that I've had in my life. So what have we covered so far? In a very basic manner, we have covered the understanding of the love of God through how He has expressed this through His Word, through His Son, and through revelation, through His Spirit. But Paul did not just pray for our hearts to be directed to the love of God, but also to the patience of Christ. And that forms our second division. Now, the word patient here is not quite talking about the ability or willingness to suppress annoyance when confronted with delay. But rather, it is talking about an enduring act of steadfastness to carry out a mission even though there is suffering, pain, and affliction. Now, what can we learn from Christ's patience or endurance, as it were? Through the life of Jesus, there are three things we can learn. The first thing we can learn from the life of Jesus is the importance of perseverance. Now, Christ's perseverance was evident throughout His ministry on earth. He faced opposition and rejection from religious leaders and the people He came to save. He endured physical pain, suffering on the cross, bearing the weight of sin for us. He even persevered through death and emerged victorious over the grave. Christ's perseverance serves as an example for us even as we face our own trials and challenges today. We can take comfort that Christ understands our struggles and is with us every step of the way. He gives us strength to endure through difficult times and persevere in our faith. We sometimes give up, don't we? The church is not doing anything to address the current issues of my life. I'm lost, confused, hopeless. I feel irritated with this illness that I cannot get rid of. Why am I constantly sick and afflicted? I am a Christian, but why am I not experiencing joy in my work? Why does He have to take my loved one away? Why am I being cancelled for my faith? I don't want to profess my faith in public anymore because it has become uncool and narrow-minded. Know that these things will come. And as the letter to Thessalonians warns us that in the coming days, it will get worse. And the men of lawlessness will continue to come and create confusion and delusion. But we also have a good Father who pre-warns us and builds us up through the Word of God to stand firm against these things. just as a good father prepares the child for the path and not the path for the child. The second thing we can learn from the life of Jesus is the value of trusting God. You know, just like a runner, Christ sets his eyes on the prize, knowing that the pain and suffering he would endure would ultimately lead to a greater goal of salvation of humanity. So he endured all this pain and humiliation on the cross because he stayed focused on his mission to reconcile humanity to God. Just like a runner must pace himself during a race, Christ demonstrated endurance throughout his life and ministry. He did not rush his mission. Instead, he trusted in God's timing, in his good time and in his guidance. He patiently endured the skepticism and the opposition from religious leaders and misunderstandings even amongst his disciples. He had to trust the process. And this was the word that was given to me. As a runner myself, I also, you know, every runner's goal is to run faster, correct? I mean, to enjoy the running and to eventually have a goal of like running faster, to be fitter, to be stronger. And so I did. So I started running with following this system called the Methodist system, whereby, all right, you run at a very low heart rate. You take 180 of your max heart you just take 180 minus your age. So let's say I'm 40. I'm supposed to run at 140 heart rate all the time, and it's painful. It's a very, very painful process because you're running really, really, really slowly. But all the guys in the running community will say, trust the process, and one day you will run at 140 heart rate at a very, very fast pace. I'm not there yet, but I'm continuing to trust the process because Jesus trusted the process. He knew the end goal, and he ran the race. He ran with perseverance, trusting the process, trusting God that he will bring vindication to men. It is important to note that perseverance doesn't simply mean enduring through difficult circumstances. It involves a steadfast commitment to God's will and purpose for our lives. It means continuing to follow Christ even when it's hard or unpopular. It means putting our trust in God even when we don't understand his plan. It is about trusting that vindication will eventually come. And that's the message that Paul has to the Thessalonians. The second coming is true. So stay steadfast in the message, even today. Corrie ten Boom says it well. When the train goes through the tunnel and it gets dark, you don't throw away the ticket and jump off. You sit still and trust the engineer. Now, the third thing we can learn from the life of Jesus is the power of forgiveness. We all know that forgiveness is a choice. Jesus made a deliberate choice to forgive those who wronged him. Even when he has every right to seek revenge or hold a grudge, he demonstrated that forgiveness is not a feeling, but a conscious decision to let go of anger, bitterness, and resentment. You want to learn how to persevere in life like Jesus? Then learn how to forgive. If Jesus had not forgave the people who wronged him, he would not have made it to the cross. He didn't die a bitter man. He died a better man than most. If you want to go through this life, you know, to end this race well, let go of bitterness and resentment in your life. When you hold on to all these things, it's going to drag you slower and slower. Be like Jesus. When he went onto the cross, he was so zen. He went on the cross and said, forgive these people because they do not know what they are doing. For us to end our life here on earth, we need to be like him. Let go. Forgive. So what are the implications of these two points for both the Church of Thessalonians and of the church of today? What is the action point? If we were to just read the verse at face value, then we might conclude that Paul's prayer was so just that we have a better appreciation of God's love and Christ's endurance. Right? Yes, that is a given. But there's more. Here we can dig deeper. And since we only have one verse to dissect today, we might as well mutilate it and dig it to the core of it. All right? So bear with me. You see, Paul prays to the Lord that the Lord would direct their hearts and our hearts. The question is, direct them to what? Paul says, to the love of God and to the patience of Christ. In Greek, these are called genitive phrases. Now, the genitive is a grammatical case that shows possession or relationship. Like, for instance, people's power, the power belonging to people. The preposition of is the standard way of to express the genitive case in Greek. So for people's power in the Bible, it would be translated as the power of the people. Get me? But, however, the English word of is rather vague. For instance, the phrase, the love of chocolate. If you take love as the object and chocolate as the subject, we will be taking the phrase to mean the chocolate's love. But can chocolate possess love? Not quite. So the phrase, the love of chocolate, can logically be only translated as the love for chocolate, with love being the subject and chocolate as the object. A bit confusing, I know. But let me just crystallize this for you more. Say if I were to bless you saying, may the love of God fill your heart. What do I mean? It could be taken two ways. Number one, a wish that God's love for you would fill your heart. Number two, a wish that your heart would be full of love for God. Now, the genitive phrase, love of God, can be interpreted various ways. In this case, the first option is a subjective genitive, which means that God is the subject of the action. Now, the second is an objective genitive, which means that God is the object of the action. And so, if the author intends for the phrase to mean both ways, and this is what we call a plenary genitive, where the case functions both as the subject and object of the verbal idea, we'll use the word English word of. Okay? So back to 2 Thessalonians 3:5. What do we make of the two genitives, to the love of God and to the patience of Christ? Now, let me just share with you a cheat code this morning. This is the preacher's best-kept secret, and today, since the pastors are not around, I tell you, but you don't tell them, okay? If you have a Bible app, YouVersion or whatever, right? If you were to look at the NET translation, you will find that there are these speech bubbles at the end of the verse or in between the verses, right? If you click on it, it'll give you information to give you a better sense of the original Greek word and how it's being translated and the issues that are surrounding the translation. Here, in 2 Thessalonians 3:5, the NET explains to us that this possibly, and I think there are probably are plenary genitives because of the context that we are in. That is, they both carry the subjective and objective sense, and both are grammatically possible in this case. So here, we are talking both about both God's love and the love for God. Now, here's the significance. What this means is that this verse and the NET says that the emphasis will be on the believers being directed toward the love God gives, which in turn produces increased love in them for Him. Now, if you don't understand anything of what I've just said, it is okay. Just know that this verse should be translated as this. Now, may the Lord direct your hearts to God's love for you, that you may increasingly love Him, and to Christ's steadfast resolve that you may stand steadfast in Him. So what is the action point of this verse? It's not just so a one-way appreciation of God's love, but it is to enter it and increase in your love for God. It's not just so a one-way appreciation of Christ's endurance, but for us to enter it and remain steadfast in Him. So Paul wrote this so that the Thessalonians' love and patient endurance might increase. That is the call for the Thessalonian church, and it is also the call of the church today. What's the point of knowing God's love? It is so that we will love Him increasingly more. How do we love God more? Words of affirmation in our praise and worship. Sing louder. Because God the Father receives words of affirmation through that. quality time spent in our daily devotion, acts of service for God's kingdom, your monetary gifts or material gifts for the extension of the work of the kingdom, physical touch in proxy to those who need comfort, because it is said that whatever you do for the least of my brothers, you are doing it for me. If you want to love God, you can. Because love is not an emotional disposition. It is a volitional undertaking. Which means that if you will yourself to love God, you can. What's the point of knowing Christ's patience? It is so that we may stand firm in Him. And how to stand firm in Him? Refer to the sermon on the 19th of March entitled Standing Firm. I heard not bad. YouTube can find. Now, all jokes aside, Pastor Lynette quoted a theologian called Karl Barth during Easter. Now, Karl Barth was a Swiss Reformed theologian who lived from 1886 to 1968. He is widely regarded as one of the most influential theologians of the 20th century. He wrote one of the most important theological works of the century called The Church Dogmatics. I tried reading it. It is very good because I don't understand a single thing about it. So it must be good. Yeah, my lecturer says it's good, so I think it should be good. It's so cheap that there are entire books written to explain the church dogmatics that Karl Barth wrote. Well, I do understand. It's not that bad. But towards the end of his life, this brilliant man who wrote the church dogmatics, he was asked to sum up his life's work in a single sentence. And his response was this: Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Wow. From the most influential theologian of the 20th century. That seems like a simple and maybe even childish statement, but yet it was a profound expression of Barth's understanding of the Christian faith. That is the fundamental truth that Jesus loves us and that His love is the foundation of our faith and our hope. There's nothing too chim about it. And let me end by reading one of the early versions of this song that was written. Remember, I told you it was written for a sick child. And I hope that it will direct you to the love of God and encourage you through your difficult times. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. They are weak, but He is strong. Jesus loves me, He who died. Heaven's gate to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let His little child come in. Jesus loves me still, though I'm very weak and ill. From His shining throne on high, comes to watch me where I lie. Jesus loves me, He will stay, close beside me all the way. If I love Him when I die, He will take me home on high. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. And so, my friends in AMC, Jesus loves you. And may the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Come, let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for your everlasting love that you have given us in this life. We give you thanks for the word, your letter of love to all of us here, so that we may understand the expressions, the many different various kinds of expressions of love that you have shown. We also give you thanks for the Holy Spirit to help us understand further your heart, your desire through your word. Sometimes we don't even open that book. Sometimes we fall away. We don't want to spend quality time with you. Sometimes we are too busy with our own work.
Sometimes we are too busy with our own lives, running around ragged. We pray this morning that you will direct us. You will direct our hearts to your love. You will direct our hearts to the steadfastness of your Son, so that we can learn to love you more, so that we can stand firm in our daily trials. Father, Lord, we pray that even as we continue to advance your gospel in this dark, dark world, and even as the light grows strangely dim, we can encounter you in many ways. Take not away our devotion for you. Oh, Father, help us to grow in love more and more with you, Jesus. And Father, I just pray that you will enable us, equip us, stir within our hearts a desire to want to know you more. That the words in the Bible will not just remain words and mere words only, but that these words will be words that transform lives, our lives. And so increase our love for you and for one another. Increase our perseverance in this life. Let us not be ashamed of the gospel as we advance it. And so, Father, this morning, we pray for anyone who has trouble, who has doubts in you, who has trouble understanding your love because of the differing experience that we all have, the way we receive love. Father, will you touch them right now? Will you touch right through the core of their heart, that they may experience you, the tingling experience, the physical touch? Father, Lord, we pray for your Spirit to descend into this place, this sanctuary right now, and that you'll cast all doubts away, and you'll come and stir within the hearts of men, evoke a sense of purpose and life, this Christian life that you have given us, a life that is full of abundance, a life that is not defeated because you have defeated sin. And so, Father, this day, fill us with your Spirit. Give us the power. Show us that you are real. Enter into our hearts so that we will increasingly love you more, and that we'll increase in our perseverance in this life, even though sometimes it can be difficult and tough. Father, I just pray for my friends here in AMC that you will release their bitterness and resentment against things of this world. That even as they continue to run this race of life, as they approach the finishing line, continue to give them this vision of what the end goal is. Continue to run alongside them to encourage them. Continue to help them pace themselves and let go of baggages that drag them down. Father, this morning, we want to declare that we live to love you. We live to honor you. We live to worship you. Let us just sing that right now.